Hello everyone. Narcissist Free Almost here, and this week's topic is going to be on the Oedipal complex, a brief overview. I think this stage of development is the most important to talk about because, it is my belief this is where the narcissists and borderlines are so successful when it comes to parental alienation. I found it difficult to find any material where someone has made this connection, but with the help of Klein and Masterson, I'll give it a shot in this series. According to Masterson, the self's capacity for intimacy, and there's those capacities again, emerges and evolves through the stages of separation individuation or through the stages of subjective and verbal self to the Oedipal stage, and is then tested and refined during adolescence and adulthood. Recall, in the separation individuation stage, the self emerges and develops to take on its full capacities. A successful separation individuation, which never happens for the narcissist, by the way, leads to the emergence of a whole self-representation with a relationship of mutual trust between self and object, the self having a realistic sense of entitlement and support and a realistic sense of life's difficulties and frustrations. Completion of the separation individuation stage, which, if you recall, happens roughly between 0 to 3 years of age, leads to the Oedipal stage. The child enters this stage with an autonomous self and the capacity to see the object as whole. The child then invests the parent of the opposite sex with sexual and affectionate feelings, which take precedence over the formerly one-dimensional view of the parent as caretaker. In other words, the relationship becomes sexualized and competition arises with the same-sex parent. The conflicts submerge under the force of repression during the latency period, roughly between 5 to 12 years of age. As you can see from this description, there's a whole host of opportunities for the opposite sex parent to exploit. And, I emphasize here opposite sex parent, because that's the first red flag that parental alienation might have taken place. That is, if the relationship closeness persists well into adolescence and adulthood, while simultaneously demonizing the same-sex parent. And as I get more in-depth on this topic, in the next part you will see how this all works. That said, I really wanted to spend the rest of the video on some background of the Oedipus complex, how it originated, and the actual process one goes through until resolution. As you probably already know, Sigmund Freud coined this term to describe the rivalry a child develops with the same-sex parent for sexual attentions of their opposite-sex parent. The complex was named after the title character in Sophocles' Oedipus Rex. In this Greek tragedy, Oedipus is abandoned by his parents as a baby. As an adult, he unknowingly kills his father and marries his mother. Freud saw in Oedipus a lack of awareness, and his predicament was childlike, thus mirroring his theory. According to his developmental theory, Oedipal conflicts occur during the phallic stage, around the ages of 3 to 6 years. The phallic stage of development is when libido, or life force, is concentrated in the erogenous zones of the child's body. And during this time, the child experiences an unconscious feeling of desire for their opposite sex parent, and jealousy and envy towards the same sex parent. For the boy, he experiences conflict because of an unconscious, pleasurable desire for his mother. Envy and jealousy are aimed at the father, and these feelings for the mother and rivalry toward the father lead to fantasies of getting rid of father and taking his place. These hostile feelings lead to castration anxieties, and this is irrational fear that the father will remove his penis as punishment. To cope with the anxiety, the son identifies with the father, and now the father becomes a role model rather than a rival. Through the defense mechanism of identification with the aggressor, boys then acquire their superego and male sex role. Later, the boy substitutes his desire for his mother with the desire for other women. Signs that an Oedipal conflict are at play in boys, for example, you will see possessiveness of mother, telling dad not to hug her. In 1913, Carl Jung expanded on this theory, adding the term Elektra complex for girls. By the way, Freud wasn't too keen on this idea, saying that the Oedipus complex applied to both girls and boys. So Elektra is another tragic Greek mythological figure, and starts with the premise that the girl realizes she lacks a penis, blames her mother, and develops resentment toward her, as well as penis envy. I know, just a tad bit sexist, you think? But remember, I'm just the messenger here. Ha. Anyway, at the same time, the girl starts to see her father as a love object. When she realizes she cannot act out her affections for her father, she becomes jealous of her mother. Eventually, the girl gives up her incestuous and rivalrous feelings, and identifies with her mother. When this process is complete, you will have the formation of the superego. Important to notice here is when the superego is formed, for both boys and girls. It's exactly at the time they resolve the Oedipal complex by identifying with the same-sex parent. Signs that a little girl is experiencing an Oedipal conflict is when they declare they want to marry their father. If you're a bit confused at this point about the genders, especially about penis envy, you're not alone. Even Freud couldn't successfully apply the Oedipal complex to girls. He postulated that girls must have a weaker superego, or maybe it's not driven as something as concrete as castration anxiety. Suffice it to say, Freud had a certain chauvinist quality to his work. I mean, lacking a penis, weak superego? Come on. But you also have to keep in mind that much of this work was done in the early 1900s, and not exactly a good time for women. Regardless, psychology still finds the Oedipus theory useful. However, the Electra complex, not so much, if hardly at all. Given this little bit of background, what is the end result if the Oedipal conflict is not resolved? Basically, this person develops unhealthy fixations to their opposite sex parent. Where boys will be fixated on their mothers and girls on their fathers. Repetition compulsion would likely come into play here, as both sexes will choose romantic partners resembling their opposite sex parent. Freud also added that he believed an unresolved Oedipus complex led to homosexuality and perversions. I'm going to stop here, and in part two I will be focusing on what Masterson says about the narcissist and borderline and their capacity for intimacy. This does directly relate to the Oedipal stage where the capacity for intimacy is formed. Also, know that the narcissist themselves, more than likely, never resolved their own Oedipal conflicts. Hell, most of them are developmentally arrested at the age of 2, and some even younger. I know for me, both ex-narcs had bizarre attachments to their mothers, with narc 2 being so compromised he literally never left home, his pathological narcissistic space. Shaking my head here, if I only knew what I know now. My life would have been a breeze. I know you can feel me out there. Ha. If you got something out of this video, give it a thumbs up, like and subscribe. I put out content once a week, usually Thursdays, so be sure to hit the notification bell for updates. Also, feel free to follow me on Facebook at NarcissistFreeAlmost, and on Instagram at Clumber_lover with a U. As always, all my love and gratitude, and I do hope you're living peace of mind narcissist free. I know I am.